the News Channel 5 Network, this is Open Line.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Open Line. I'm Carrie Sharp. Tonight's topic here on Open Line is something that I hope that you have not personally experienced, but I can assure you that a lot of people have, especially because of this coronavirus pandemic. We're talking about domestic violence, and we're going straight to the source today. We have a wonderful guest, Sharon Roberson, the president of the YWCA of Nashville and Middle Tennessee, is joining us. Before I welcome her in, I want to remind you, this is Open Line. This is your chance to call in, ask questions of our guest. You can share your experience if you have had one with the YWCA and the services they offer. If you are wondering how to help somebody who you think is suffering with domestic violence in their home, Sharon's going to be a great voice to help us sort through that. Sharon, thank you so much for being with us tonight. It really is a pleasure to have you.
But thank you so much for having me.
You're welcome. This is something that I have thought a lot about since this started, and people were really forced into their homes. And we heard early on that we will probably see a spike in domestic violence and child abuse, which is heartbreaking. Tell me what the story has been here in Middle Tennessee.
All right. Initially, I will say I'll start back with the tornadoes, because as everyone here in Middle Tennessee, we've had really tornadoes followed by the COVID-19 pandemic. But shortly after the tornadoes, we had a huge 55% spike year over year in domestic violence calls. Then things we thought were leveling out, and they've stayed still about 30 to 35% increase. One thing we have seen is that there's a lot of requests. We have a lot of requests for information, what can I do? But people are trying to appease abusers, but they really fear leaving where they are. They know they're safe, but they're having to choose between whether or not they are safe at home, unsafe at home, that is, or whether or not they go into a shelter or another place, especially when they have children. That's very daunting and very difficult decision for someone to take. And that's why at the YW, we make it clear that we are here to stand with you, to provide you with a safe, comfortable place should you need additional shelter or alternative shelter, because no one should stay in an unsafe condition just because they are trying to be safer at home. Because safer at home is not safe for everyone.
That's right. That's absolutely right. I know you all have had to adjust and change things, and that is what you are doing to ensure that people are safe. What have you done there at the shelter?
Oh, we've done tremendous work from the very beginning, really in March, when the mayor announced the Safer at Home initiative. Even before that, we took steps to make sure that we would keep the Weaver Domestic Violence Center open. We're very dedicated to our mission, and if we do nothing else, we're going to make sure that anyone that needs a safe haven from abuse, we are there with you. So what we have done is a number of things. First of all, we've made sure that everyone that comes into the Weaver Center is checked out thoroughly. We do this not only to protect them and get them the resources they may need should they be sick, but also to protect both the individuals and the women and children in our shelter, as well as our staff. And so we have a protocol that we've worked with the Metro Health Department and the CDC. I'm actually on a national committee that's looking at ways in which shelters can make sure they remain safe. And we put all those protocols in place. We also have a separate facility we were able to get funding for that's on the same grounds as the Weaver Center, that provides for intakes. So when you first come in, you may not come into the general area, general population of the shelter until you've been thoroughly vetted. And we help people get the resources if they need testing or show signs. We work very closely to make sure that you are able to be as safe as possible in coming in. And we've been very fortunate. We've had no positive cases in the Weaver Center, but we have had a lot of testing, really vetting, If people should leave for any reason and come back, they go through the same protocol. It seems very strict, but it's a way that we want to make sure we stay safe.
Sure, it's about protecting people and people who are already there as right. well. Tell me about the Weaver Center. I mean, even without all of this coronavirus stuff, if someone has never heard of it, didn't know it was an option, or just unsure of what it offers and what you all offer, tell me about that.
Well, I will say this a little bit. The YW has been in the Nashville community for 122 years. Three of those years, we have been in the domestic violence services space. You actually could arguably say we've been in that space even longer. And the reason for that is that before it was called domestic violence or anyone wanted to recognize it, we were helping women who were in those critical situations. With that said, the Weaver Center has been around for about 40 years, and it is a beautiful facility. It's not at all what people think it is when they hear the word shelter. We really call it the Weaver Domestic Violence Center because it's very much like a dorm setting. Beautiful rooms, open spaces, play area for the children. We work to make it sort of a family atmosphere, state-of-the-art kitchens, and the reason why we want it to be like that, because we want it to be a place of healing and safety so you feel very secure so that you're taken care of. And we've gone the extra miles during the COVID-19 in order to make sure that it stayed as sanitary as possible. We want to make sure that everyone really feels comfortable. And I must say, I've been working there every day since March the 15th. And normally I go between our two campuses, and I will say that the people there have really, really appreciated all the measures we have taken. And it's very comfortable and secure to know that they can be there with their children and they are safe, mm-hmm. not only someone from the abuser, but also they are safe with the pandemic in the community.
When someone is staying there as a guest, they have fled an abusive home, what kind of services are provided to them?
Well, first of all, you can come into the Weaver Center, and some people do, with just the clothes on their back. Wow. They've been escorted by a police officer. They've come there with their children. Some of them don't even have their purses and IDs, but we take you there. We feed you, we comfort you, we give you a warm place to sleep, we give you therapy services, we help you with your housing needs, job needs. We do whatever we can to help you transition to a better life, because we really believe that everyone has a bright future and we want to invest in you. So it's just not simply giving you the safety. We want to take you to that next step, so that you can have a successful outcome, which means helping you all in all facets of your life, helping you connect with the services in the community, helping your children get back into their schooling, get their education. These are all things that we provide. It's a holistic approach.
That's wonderful. And I know that you guys are always evolving and changing to meet people's needs. You were telling me right before we started that you started a text line, and it's been very successful and shown that it's very needed.
Yes. We started that because we understood that often is very difficult. We actually had this ready to launch even before COVID-19. However, once it hit, we found it's been very, very useful, because really that is the avenue when you're really there in an abusive household and you can't talk. Mm-hmm. It's much easier to have those kind of conversations. And it's worked out very well. One thing we found out is our data showed us that most of our intakes, we take people in 24/7 and we're open 24/7, but most of the intakes come typically during the business hours. And we are trying to look more closely at that data, because we don't know if that's because that's the time, let's say you're a victim of abuse, you go to, let's say, your job, you pick up your children, you come to Weaver. Or often that may be when you have the freedom to gather your things and to leave. Because one thing we know is if you decide you want to leave an abusive situation, you must be very careful. And you should only do that if you have really gone through the process of doing what we call a safety plan. And our crisis counselors can help you develop a safety plan, because leaving without that plan could really put you in danger, in more danger, that is.
Tell me more about that safety plan. So what I'm hearing is that people may call and say, I need out, but maybe they're not ready to leave right at that moment. And your counselors can say, let's think about these things and make a plan and start the process. What does that process look like?
That process is really on an individual basis, determining what they need to do to, first of all, if they want to stay, to be as safe as possible. There's actually what's called a lethality assessment program, which we have, which the YW has trained all the Metro Nashville police officers on a protocol, which they go through when they are on a domestic violence call. They ask a series of questions, and based on that question, those questions, they can determine whether or not the individual's particular situation can become lethal in the future. We also do that kind of analysis when you call into our crisis call line. And the reason for that is some people may not realize the danger they're in, but there are things, you know, I don't want to be too graphic, but there are things such as, have you ever been choked? Has an individual ever held you at gunpoint? Those things, some, for some people, sound obvious, but not necessarily to others, because people get very used to a certain way of life, and a lot of things that they think are normal or have become normalized, but they are not normal. And abuse takes a lot of forms. Mm-hmm. When you talk to the women at the shelter, they will tell you the easiest abuse to get over is the physical. It's the psychological abuse that's the most difficult to overcome. And you know, when your self-esteem has been broken, you're down to nothing, it's very difficult to make the change in your life.
How has the coronavirus made these fragile and very dangerous situations even worse?
The coronavirus has really given people who are abusive another weapon. If you leave, you'll be out there. No one will take care of you when you're sick. Anything that could be used to really gain that power and control, because the essence of domestic violence is a power and control relationship, whether or not it's psychological, physical, or financial. Financial violence is huge, that controlling aspect. So when a person that's abusive sees that they might lose control, that's when they strike out. And that is a very, very dangerous time. So a lot of things are out of people's control during this pandemic. People are losing jobs, which is a terrible, terrible thing. Children are not in school, so they're at home 24/7. Childcare services are disrupted. And when you have the economics that hit you along with the change in lifestyle, that really takes volatile relationships to the edge. And so it actually magnifies really what were relationships that were on the edge anyway.
You know, Sharon, when I say domestic violence, I think of two adults fighting, or the abuse between two adults. How often do kids figure into this picture as being abused as well in one form or another?
Oh, they are victims of domestic violence also. Not only the physical kind, but children that witness domestic violence are so much more likely to either become victims, mm-hmm, or become abusers. And it seems sort of strange that some children that may even resent what they saw happening, but that sort of exposure to violence, even if you aren't physically touched yourself, has such a detrimental effect on the children. And you really, it takes a long time for them to work through that process. Many adults that I've talked to who have been children who grew up in families that were full of violence actually had to work very hard so that that didn't become a part of their lifestyle.
Gosh, that's just heartbreaking when you think about it, and think
it
about
is.
Just the cycle of it all and what is happening more often in homes right now. We're going to take a quick commercial break. I want to remind everybody at home, if you have a question, go ahead and give us a call, 615-737-PLUS. We'll get that answered. Stay with us.